right around the corner. I mean, just like right there. It's coming. Everybody say it's coming. Then, on the other side of Thanksgiving is Christmas. Everybody say Christmas.
Christmas.
Coming. It's right around the corner. And so, this is a time of year where families get together, holidays, everybody does their thing. And this is a time of year where, you know, Thanksgiving happens before Christmas, and we are thankful because of all the things that God has done for us. How many here tonight can truly say you are thankful?
Yes.
Let me ask women. I should have asked this first. How many of you can truly say you are blessed?
Yes.
Okay, because you got to know that first. We cannot even talk about being thankful until we talk about being blessed. Okay? We could, but it doesn't have as much impact. So, what I want to talk to you about tonight is something that is every one of us should be a part of. In today's society, in today's culture, it's a lot of things. But one thing we're seeing that there's not a lot of, and that is thankfulness. Now, I know we just started, financially, I think in the last 14 years, I don't think that I have gotten up and really been as much of a pulling pastor when it comes to financially. You know, we might get up and take up a special offering, every once in a while. But I'm not one that, I'm not an L.A. preacher. Anybody know what I'm talking about? I didn't know until just a few days ago. Apparently, there's a new show on television called The Preachers of L.A. The only way I know about it is because somebody sent me a YouTube video of apparently TV Jakes like calling out these L.A. preachers, you know. But so I thought, what in the world is this? So I just got to dig around looking, and there is a new series, I guess, that started this fall that is called The Preachers of L.A., and it's like four or five of these millionaire preachers. And it's these preachers that they preach, they have large churches, they do all this thing, but they absolutely positively love the money. Like they're driving, you know, one of them drives a Bentley, and the other one drives a Mercedes, and I mean, you cannot imagine, and they say, they have no problem, you know, with, I saw a little interview on YouTube, they were interviewing and said, I have no problem, he said, you know, the Word of God talks about being blessed, and so this what? Well, here's the thing, the Word of God does talk about you being blessed, and God wants you to be blessed. Okay? But where a lot of people get into trouble, and where a lot of preachers get into trouble, is where they let the money do the talking. And where what they do, all that they do in church, what have you, is all about the money. See, I've even seen through the years, I've seen pastors treat people differently based upon their incomes. I've seen pastors treat people because they had a lot of money, Brother McCain, they really, you know, treated them better than other people. And then the people that didn't have a lot of money, when it came to giving in the church, those people barely got any time whatsoever. And that is wrong on every level, okay? So we'll establish a little bit of that later on. But what I want to get into tonight is really not, we're not going to be talking about money per se, okay? I want this church to know. And I think that all of the body of believers in the apostolic movement, we need to understand how to become a culture of thankfulness. If we don't know how to be thankful and grateful for what God has done for us, we are in trouble. I said we're in trouble. All right? So, in the book of Deuteronomy, turn there, book of Deuteronomy chapter 28, beginning with verse number 1. And as you turn there, I want you, we're going to read some very, very important scriptures here, and we're going to really get a handle on how God wants us to be. And I'm going to be throwing several scriptures at you tonight, so that's why you have a piece of paper to write it down. All right, let's start Deuteronomy chapter 28 and verse number 1. I apologize, I do not have these scriptures up here yet, so just look at them in your Bible, and that would be fantastic. All right, start for me, verse number 1, if you would.
And it shall come to pass, thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and do all his commandments which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth.
Okay, read down to verse number 6.
And all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee.
Now listen, all these blessings shall come on thee and do what? Overtake thee. Alright, that is a forceful action. That doesn't mean he comes up and says, tag, you're it. To overtake means to get control of. Okay? Read on.
If thou shalt hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, blessed shalt thou be in the city, blessed shalt thou be in the field. Blessed shall be the fruit of thy body, and the fruit of thy ground, and the fruit of thy cattle, the increase of thy kine, and the flocks of thy sheep. Blessed shall be thy basket and thy store. Blessed shalt be thou when thou comest in, blessed shalt thou be when thou goest out.
Alright, now go to verse 15 of that same chapter. Now watch this. Verse 15 through 19.
But it shall come to pass, that will not hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe, to do all his commandments and his statutes which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee.
Now he's talking about being overtaken by curses, not blessings. Okay, read on.
Cursed shalt thou be in the city, cursed shalt thou be in the field. Cursed shalt be thy basket and thy store. Cursed shalt be the fruit of thy body and the fruit of thy land, the increase of thy kine and the flocks of thy sheep. Cursed shalt thou be when thou comest in.
Alright, thank you very much. Now, in the book of Deuteronomy, we see Moses, 120 years old, okay? And in just a few days, he's going to be going up into the mountain, and he's going to die. So what he's doing here is he is giving the last of the last instructions to the people of God. What he's doing is he is releasing the reins really by which he has been guiding these people these 40 years now, and he's about to turn them over now to Joshua. But here's what Moses is doing. He is sort of rehearsing for the children of Israel again the conditions by which they would enjoy this land. Moses is teaching them that if you want to enjoy the blessings of God, there are conditions. Everybody say conditions. The conditions upon which God's blessings were predicated. The children of Israel had a covenant relationship with God that revolved around the law and around their obedience to the law. Now, as much as we want to believe that God loves us so much that he would bless us no matter what we do, we need to understand that a lot of his blessings are conditional. Now, there's some blessings out there that people receive and they don't do a thing for God. I would think that probably the most important one would be breathing in and breathing out.
Yeah, that's right.
There's all kinds of horrible, deplorable, terrible, mean, sinful people out there that are still alive today. Right? Blessing number one. Not to mention, you throw in a place to live, a nice car, clothes, friends, happy-go-lucky lifestyle, whatever. All those are blessings. And these are people that absolutely do not give a thing to God. But we know God is a God of blessings.
Right.
But God is very particular about his blessings. You understand that God wants to bless his people more than just breathing in and breathing out. I mean, he really does. So many people in the church have the mentality of just getting by. God doesn't want you just to get by. He doesn't necessarily want you to be a millionaire. If you become one, fantastic. More power to you. But God wants you to do more than just get by. It is his desire to bless those who have not known him, because he hopes that they will realize where these blessings come from, and then have a heart to turn their life over to God and then begin to serve him. But I'm going to tell you tonight, what God is most interested in, above all else, is to bless those who are committed and obedient to his word. That's what God wants to do. Okay? Now, one day, everybody in this world is going to be held accountable for what God has given them. They're going to stand before God, and God's going to say, I gave you life. What did you do with it?
Right.
I gave you a home. What did you do with it?
Right.
I gave you a beautiful family. What did you do with them? I gave you money, finances. What did you do with it?
Right.
So everybody is going going to be held accountable for this. And we have scriptures we're going to be reading in just a minute. But here's the thing. God blesses disobedient people and even non-believers, really, just to prove a point. The point being that we do not receive anything in our lives based upon our merits or righteousness. That's awesome right there. Okay. Are they all going to do that? Maybe not. Okay. Okay, this is what I said right here. All right, this is what this said. We do not receive anything in our lives based upon our merits or our righteousness.
Right.
Nothing that you do because you're a good person will secure all these blessings. God blesses you because He wants to.
Right.
What are you saying, Brother Maroney? I'm saying that you cannot do enough good work to secure this or secure that. I know people that have this attitude. They literally have this attitude. Well, I don't know why I always struggle. I do this, I do that, and then they start saying, I do this more. Sister Johnson, she don't work nothing like me. And they start having this attitude. Right? And then they start, judging other people. And that is not what God wants us to do. Okay, likewise, disobedience can be and often is rewarded by strict and severe consequences. But again, the true reward for that comes when we stand before God on the day of judgment. Now, here's the thing about the law. The law could make nothing righteous. Okay? It only pointed away to a better covenant that was to come. I don't live under a law that delivers blessings or punishment. In fact, even the presence of the law itself contained a condition that was placed upon every one of God's people. It almost appeared as a stand-alone condition, if you will, for every one of them. And it wasn't complicated, it wasn't tricky, and it wasn't unfair. Actually, it was perfectly balanced. It gave the individual the opportunity to decide between blessings and curses. Okay? Would everybody on this side say blessing?
Blessing.
Everybody on this side say curses.
Curses.
Okay. You are the blessing side. You are the curses side. Alright? Maybe we'll switch in a minute. Okay. Now, what would help with this decision, really, would be a list of answers. How am I going to make this decision, Lord? I'll tell you how. The Lord says, I'm going to tell you what you will be if you are blessed. Ready? And I'm going to tell you what will happen to your life if you are cursed. At the end of that list of answers for both of those, you need to make a decision what kind of people you will be. Will you be a blessed people or will you be a cursed people? Okay? Simply listen to God and be grateful to Him. Be obedient to His word. But here's what happened. Israel began to live as if it was no big deal. And it was a big deal. So, gratitude, and I want to say this, write this down, mark this down. Gratitude is a big deal to God. I cannot say that enough. Gratitude is a big deal to God. If you eat and you're not thankful, it's a big deal to God. If you go to your job every day and you complain on your way to work every single day, God help you.
That's right, amen.
You could not have a job.
That's right.
Amen.
Right? Gratitude's a big deal. Got clothes on your back, you better be thankful for it. Family with at least halfway decent health, you better be thankful to God. Gratitude's a big deal. In fact, it was such a big deal, we were commanded concerning gratitude. Commands, okay? There were offerings in the sacrificial system which were made specifically to give thanks. Okay? They had to give an offering just to give thanks. In fact, thanksgiving as a means of giving thanks occurs 28 times in 27 verses beginning in the book of Leviticus. There's a whole lot of thanksgiving offerings there. Turn to Leviticus chapter 7, beginning with verse number 11. Okay? Leviticus chapter 7, beginning with verse number 11. Okay. Leviticus 7, verse number 11. And this is the law of the sacrifice of peace offering, which he shall offer unto the Lord. If he offer it for a what?
Thanksgiving.
For a what?
Thanksgiving.
Then he shall offer with the sacrifice of thanksgiving, watch, unleavened cakes mingled with oil, unleavened wafers anointed with oil, cakes mingled with oil of fine flour, fried. Don't tell me God doesn't like fried food. Don't you tell me. When people look at me and say, now I know, let me apologize, Sister Maroney. That's not supposed to be that way. She's looking at it squinting. You need your reading glasses. Where are your reading glasses? Okay. I don't know what's going on there, but you should have your Bibles. All right. God likes fried food.
Yes.
So the next time you're eating something fried, somebody comes up and says, that's not good for you. You tell them to hush their mouth. It's in the Bible.
Yes. Yes, sir.
So I'm reading it wrong, but I don't think I am.
Fried.
Besides the cakes. It's funny. A couple mornings ago, Colin got up and he walked in the room and he had the sleepers in his eyes and he said, and he had this look on his face, you know, real long face, and he said, Dad, he said, I dreamed all last night about cakes. I mean, as soon as he said cakes, he smiled that quick. Alright. Besides the cakes, not that kind of cake. He shall offer for his offering leavened bread with the sacrifice of thanksgiving of his peace offering. And of it he shall offer one out of the whole oblation for a heave offering to the Lord. And it shall be the priest that sprinkle the blood of the peace offerings, and the flesh of the sacrifice of his peace offerings for thanksgiving shall be eaten the same day that it is offered. He shall not leave any of it until the morning. Did you hear that? He shall not leave any of it until the morning. God hates leftovers.
Oh, yeah.
I could really preach that right here, but for sake of time. God does not like leftovers. So ladies, stop trying to feed your man leftovers. We don't do leftovers in our house. She tries, but it just doesn't happen. Oh, Brother Murray, it's so wasteful to throw that food out. God said, you don't eat all of it, get rid of it. When it came to the manna, he didn't want any of that left over either. In fact, it rotted and it grew worms and stank. I'm not preaching against leftovers, friend. I'm just trying to tell you what the Bible says. Alright. He says, what's the point here? You need to be so thankful that you eat all of it. You understand? Eat as much as you, not gorge, not be a glutton. Here's the point. This is what happens. We pick and choose. We don't like this, we don't like that. And before you know it, we've got nothing but waste laying around us. Okay? Because we just pick and choose. So, it showed gratitude. When you ate it, didn't leave any of it, you ate it. It showed gratitude. Okay? Now, the same day that it was offered, don't leave any of it until the next day beyond that to throw out. Look at Psalms 100 and verse number 3. Psalms 100 and verse number 3. Yeah, I don't know what's going on with this. It's something's messing up. All right. Psalms 100, verses 3 through 5. Read that for me.
Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that has made us, not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name.
When you come into his presence, you come into these gates, you are to come being thankful.
Yes.
Okay? Thankful. Thank you, God, for allowing me to come to church. Thank you, God, for giving me church. Thank you, Lord, for this. Thank you for this. Thankful. Let us be a thankful people. Okay? Let us be a thankful people. Read on.
For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth through all generations.
Okay, being thankful is a requirement and condition to God's blessing. Brother Maroney, I just want to be blessed. I just wish I was more blessed. You know how you get more blessed? You got to be thankful, right? You got to be thankful because it is a requirement and a condition to God's blessings. Now, Israel was a nation that had no trouble being unthankful. They showed many times that they didn't have any difficulty being unthankful. They became a culture, if you will, of unthankfulness, as we'll soon see in just a minute. Their ingratitude, rather, caused many curses to be put upon their lives. Let me just tell you this. People can talk about preachers of L.A. They talk about churches that always beg for money. All the preacher preaches about money. All the, you know, what do you want? But let me tell you something. Those are all your opinions. It's all whatever. The Word of God says, if you are not grateful, you will not be blessed. If you do not show that gratitude, it will bring a curse on your life. Okay? All right. Now, Deuteronomy 26 and verse number 1. It's as if God and Moses knew that Israel would struggle because they were instructed that when they came into the promised land, the first thing that they were supposed to do was give thanks and to show it. They had to show that they were thankful. And they did it by giving. Read Deuteronomy chapter 26, beginning with verse number 1.
And it shall be when thou art come into the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee for an inheritance and possess it and dwell therein, that thou shalt take of the first of all the fruit of the earth, which thou shalt bring in thy land.
Yeah, you're going to take of the what?
Fruit of the earth.
Back it up.
Thou shalt take of the first.
The first of the fruit of the earth. Okay.
First.
Yep.
Take the first of all the fruit of the earth, which thou shalt bring of thy lands, that the Lord thy God giveth thee.
Now listen very carefully when he reads this. Go ahead.
And shalt put it in a basket.
Put it in a basket.
And shalt go unto the place which the Lord thy God shall choose to place his name there.
Go ahead.
And thou shalt go unto the priest that shall be in those days, and say unto him, I profess this day the Lord thy God, that I have come into the country which the Lord sware unto our fathers to give us. The priest shall take the basket out of thy hand and set it down before the altar of the Lord thy God.
Okay, now, it was there that they were to confess and declare that starting with Jacob, who went down into Egypt with just a few. Verse 25 says, during a 400-year period, he came out of Egypt as a great multitude. Everybody say, he was blessed. God delivered them out of Egypt's bondage and led them to a land flowing with milk and honey. And you know what Moses was saying? He was saying, rehearse your gratitude every day until you come into the land.
Right.
He went in with a little. He came out with a lot. He said, take the first fruit. Take what you have. Put it in a basket. Take it to the church. Give it to the priest. Lay it on the altar and give thanks unto God. That sound familiar?
Yes.
It ought to.
Yes.
And he said, that's how you show your gratitude. But Moses was saying, look, rehearse this. Rehearse your gratitude every day until you come into the promised land. You know what we as a church should be doing every day? Rehearsing our gratitude.
Right.
Every day. Every day. Know that what we have only comes from God. You hear me? James Maroney, no matter how much money I work for, no matter how much money the J-Mar Cleaning ever gets me, it is not my money.
Right.
God can take that away from me just like that.
Amen.
Come on, somebody. God can clean out your wallet if he really wants to.
Right.
And so, all that I have, all that I am belongs to God. So, I cannot help but feel like that this is what we're supposed to be doing now. Not just because of a Thanksgiving holiday. See, that's what happens. Just like at Christmas and Easter, people go most of the year, don't hardly think about it until their battery goes dead. Run back here and get me 2 batteries, please. Because the stinking devil's trying to shut my mouth. No, not really. Battery's just went dead. Okay, because what happens is God wants us to rehearse daily to show that we are thankful for every single thing that God gives us. And so every day we need to be thanking God for delivering us, so to speak, out of Egypt. Anybody thankful for your salvation?
Yes.
Okay. You cannot buy salvation.
That's right.
You can't go into a church and pay a certain amount of tithes. Thank you very much. You can't go in church, pay a certain amount of tithes, and procure your salvation.
That's right.
It's not going to happen.
That's right.
Okay? You owe tithe and offer. offerings unto God because you are saved and because you are blessed.
Right?
So, in reality, where we are is becoming a culture and a people that are genuinely thankful for what they have. When God gives you money through your job, when God gives you clothes on your back, food on your table, you know what you're doing? You're giving to God. You're saying, God, thank you. Bless me again with another paycheck. Bless me again with another paycheck. You know what? I don't know about you, but I'm genuinely thankful that if I need a new pair of shoes, I can go get them.
Yes.
Right? Look at these kicks right here. I'm thankful that if I wanted shoes just like that, that I could go and get those. I'm thankful that if I need milk, I could go get it.
That's right.
I'm thankful that I, and not because I'm rich, because I'm blessed.
Right.
I don't know where people, you know, apostolics especially, you know, they get this thing, this mentality. Folks, you're not supposed to fall in love with your blessings as if that's the only reason why you live for God.
Right.
That is not what's supposed to happen.
That's right.
But you don't need to be afraid to be blessed.
That's right.
I'm going to tell you what that mentality is. That mentality is the same one that's just trying to talk you out of being grateful to God and showing it by your giving. It's almost like we're afraid to be blessed. We know, the Bible tells us, we don't give to get. We give because we're thankful.
Right.
We give because we did get.
Right.
Not so we can get.
Right.
But how God, in all of his awesome wisdom, worked it. That the more you give, the more he says, I'm going to bless you.
Right.
Folks, that's a really good deal, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay, now, I'm going to give God the very important, the first important thing in my life. I'm going to give it to him. I'm going to give him my life. I'm going to give him every breath that I breathe. I want to do it because I'm living for God.
Amen.
And when I get paid, I want to make sure that I reflect that I show gratitude to God, not give him the leftovers.
Right. Right.
Okay? That's why it's called first fruits.
Right.
Now, let me just give you a little... a brief how-to. It is not, okay, I'm going to take care of everything, and then whatever's left, I'm going to give it to God.
No.
God just said, when it came to tithing, he just said 10%. That's it. 90% you get to keep. 10% goes to the Lord, goes back to the Lord.
Right.
Look at Deuteronomy 26 and verse number 11. Read that, please.
And thou shalt rejoice in every good thing which the Lord thy God hath given unto thee, and unto thy house,
now, if you're blessed, your house, your home is blessed, even those that you allow to move in with you are blessed. And so, you've got to rejoice in everything. So, we have to see here that God's conditions are that we show gratitude for the things we are blessed with every day. We should rejoice when God has been good to your neighbor.
Yes.
Oh, I gotcha.
That's right.
Do you think tonight, I know I'm picking on him tonight, but he is so easy to pick on. But Brother Edmund, it's not because I love him any more than all y'all. It ain't that at all. It's just he's so easy to pick on. It's hilarious. Okay. No, he's good. He's got a good spirit about him. When he walked in with those new shoes, y'all gonna thank my brother. Well, this is for kindergartners. Trust me, I know full-blooded adults that act like kindergartners when it comes to this stuff.
Oh yes.
Oh well, somebody got paid.
Right.
Well, I bet he's not paying his tithe. If he was paying his tithe, he wouldn't be able to afford
it.
Y'all know people say this garbage.
Yes, they do.
They get a bad spirit. They get a bad attitude. And it's because their neighbor is being blessed and they feel like they're not. And so what do? They have a bad spirit and a bad attitude towards their neighbor.
Right.
You know what that is? It's a big long word. It's about this long. You ready? Jealousy.
Right.
That's all it is. It's jealousy. Do you know why he could buy those shoes?
Right.
Because he's faithful to God.
That's right.
You know why you can buy new shoes? You know why you can? Brother Jamal. Oh, let's just talk about Brother Jamal here. Hey, shoes, nothing. That ain't nothing. Give me a BMW.
Love it.
You know why he could buy a BMW? And he had to go get a filthy blue one. UK blue. Just go buy a Beamer, a blue Beamer. Get a red one. Red and black. Okay. Don't listen. Don't. Well, and people get that attitude. I've watched it happen. Hey, you think I'm joking? I've seen people backslide and leave church because of that very spirit. I've seen them walk away from God because they got jealous over somebody that was blessed. My wife raised up as a preacher's kid. I don't know, she and Brother Perry told me, Sister Perry told me, and she even told me that she would come in with a new dress on, and they make comments to a little girl. Well, I see what my ties bought this week. What happened? Did a state hospital open up, all the crazies break out, and decide to come to church? What happened? I mean, seriously? Is that what my tithes paid for? That is a horrible attitude.
Amen.
I'm telling you, those people are just begging for cursings on their life. And many of them are cursed. So, we need to be blessed, and we need to be happy when our neighbors give. But Brother Edmund, I am happy that you got a pair of beans. I am tickled pink that he got a pair of brand new shoes. Brother Garrett is too.
I am, I'm proud.
He is. He's proud. He's proud of him. I think it's fantastic. I am so thankful. You know what that means? When somebody, and folks, it's not about materialism, it's not about, but listen. When somebody, now watch, there's a catch here. When somebody's faithful to God and they can buy new clothes, they can buy a new car, that's why they can do it. It's because they're faithful to God. But then there's those people that are not faithful to God and they still buy all those things. And they don't give to the work of the Lord. Well, what's happening, Brother Roney? That means, listen, we will all be held accountable. We are all stewards of what God gives us. And when the master, when the Lord of the house comes back and says, hey, what'd you do with your money that I gave you?
Yeah.
What'd you do with it? I didn't give it to the church. I went and bought new shoes. I went and bought new car. That's what you're saying. So, hey, buy a boat, folks. Buy a yacht. Buy a new house. Buy a plane, for crying out loud. Buy a helicopter. I don't care what you do with your money.
That's right.
As long as you're faithful to God.
Right.
When you're faithful to God, it's just going to happen. Now, this is biblically based things I'm talking about here. Okay? Now, the second thing they were to do was to build altars out of uncut stones and plaster them, writing the law upon them. Look at Deuteronomy chapter number 27, beginning with verse number 4. Let's read verse number 4 through 8. 27, 4 through 8. Look at this.
Therefore it shall be when you be gone over Jordan, and you shall set up these stones which I command you this day in Mount Ebal, and thou shalt plaster them with plaster. And there shalt thou build an altar unto the Lord thy God, an altar of stones. Thou shalt not lift up any iron tool upon them. Thou shalt build the altar of the Lord thy God of whole stones. And thou shalt offer burnt offerings thereupon unto the Lord thy God. And thou shalt offer peace offerings, and shalt eat there, and rejoice before the Lord thy God. And thou shalt write upon these stones all the words of this law very plainly.
Okay, now watch. Two offerings here. Consecration and communion with God. Where? Upon an altar. Now, this is another condition of God's blessings. If you are thankful, you will spend time at an altar.
Right.
Now, I don't know where that people got the idea that this altar up here or this front row, wherever that you make an altar in our services. I don't know where people got the idea then altars were just for sinners.
Right.
Right.
Because they are not. Altars were built, are you ready? To give thanks back to God for what He had done.
Yes, sir.
You go back. Go back and look at the history of an altar. Abraham was an altar builder. Abraham didn't say, well, I'm building this so some sinner can come by and pray it, and I'm just going to sit back and watch. No. When God did something, He built an altar and offered a sacrifice. So initially, and even still today, altars are built for believers.
Right.
For people, that's why when we have an altar call, if you're grateful, you should never, never not want to get down on your knees and pray.
Right.
You understand? And I realize that we don't have a huge altar. Wherever you make your altar out there, it's nice if you come up here. It's really kind of a step. Well, we'll get into that when I talk about altars. But I'm just saying when we make that motion and get down on our knees and we're thankful and we pray to God, that's what it's about. So the purpose, its purpose was first and foremost as an object of worship. What kind of worship? Thankful worship. Everybody say thankful worship. Okay. Now, when you change the grand design of the altar, you change absolutely everything. The altar is not a place where you come if you need something.
Right.
Only. I know people that the only time they come to an altar is when they need something. And if they don't need anything, they don't go. Folks, that's not what an altar was specifically designed for. Okay? Now, it's a place where we come because we've already received. I'm thankful. I may need something in my life. And yes, I can go to an altar. Don't misunderstand me. I can go to an altar if I need something. But I don't want that to be the only reason why I go. Brother Barry, I want to go because I have.
Yes.
I want to go to an altar and give thanks to God. And thank Him because I have been blessed. So after this, Moses instructed the representatives. Now watch. What side is this? The...
Blessing.
What side?
Blessing.
What side is this?
Cursings.
Okay, now watch. After this, Moses instructed that representatives from the half of the tribes of Israel would stand on one mountain and the other half on the other mountain. And then, I want you to get the picture here. The people would stand in the valley. So on one mountain, you had the representatives of the tribe that represented blessings. On the other mountain, you had a representative of tribes that represented cursings. And in the valley, everybody say the valley.
Valley.
In the valley were the people. Now, the people in the middle would have to make the decision. Look at 27, beginning with verse number 11, please.
Moses charged the people the same day, saying, "These shall stand upon Mount Gerizim to bless the people when ye are come over Jordan. Simeon and Levi and Judah and Issachar and Joseph and Benjamin. And these shall stand upon Mount Ebal to curse Reuben, Gad, and Asher, and Zebulun, Dan, and Naphtali."
Okay, what was God doing here? God was giving the people a chance to do what? A chance to become a culture of thankfulness. To lay it all out to them as if to say, if you obey and you are thankful, you will be blessed. If not, you will be cursed. Okay? They had to make the decision. But they were told in Deuteronomy 28, verse number 1, "It came to pass that thou shalt hearken diligently to the voice of the Lord thy God." We read this in the beginning. You see all the blessings. If you look down at verse 3, "Blessed shalt thou be in the city, blessed shalt thou be in the field, blessed when you come and when you go," the whole deal. But whatever you gain in obedience and thankfulness, watch, you will lose in disobedience and unfaithfulness. Here it is, folks, plain and simple. You want to be blessed, you be thankful, and you give. If you don't want to be blessed, then you be disobedient and show ingratitude and don't give. That's what it means. That's what it means. It's a simple choice. Do I want to be a culture of thankfulness or a culture of unthankfulness? What does it need to be? Now, in verse 15, chapter 28 and verse number 15, listen to what he says. It's the same exact thing. But it shall come to pass if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God to observe all, to do all his commandments and his statutes which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee, look, and overtake thee. So now you're procuring curses in your life. He says, the same as with the blessings. It's a mirror, if you will. He says, Cursed shalt thou be in the city. Cursed you're going to be in the field. Cursed in the basket in thy store. Cursed the fruit of the body, and the fruit of the land, increase of thy kind, the flocks of thy sheep. Cursed shalt thou be when thou comest in, and cursed shalt thou be when thou goest out. These were conditional blessings, and they were curses that were based upon the covenant. Now, I believe those conditions still exist today.
Right.
I believe that if a person wants to be blessed, that they will be thankful and show that gratitude. Proverbs 14 and 34, it's only showing half the scripture. Righteousness exalteth a nation. Everybody say righteousness.
Righteousness.
But sin is a reproach to any people. Now listen very carefully as I try to crunch this in to a close here. If a nation will establish itself as a God-centered nation, it will be blessed. Do you know why America is as blessed as we are today? Not because all the rich people decided to come over here and start their own little club. That's not why. We are blessed in America today because this country was founded upon a God-centered principle. And our forefathers believed in that. Do you know why that the nation, the economy, now watch folks, do you know why that the economy and why everything is in disarray right now? Is because as a whole, our country has become a country of unthankfulness. It is the truth, folks. We used to have a time when we believed in prayer. There wasn't a classroom in America that ever started without prayer. And now we want to haggle over Christmas Day on whether or not we want to. Well, we don't need to read, we don't need to sing any songs that have to do with Christmas because it's too offensive to the, to those that are non-Christian. You know what? I'm going to tell you something. I don't usually do this. I'm not a call-in show kind of guy. But I listen to this guy on WHAS in the morning, and I like him. Leland Conrad, I think is his name. And I'm going to tell you, I've listened to him for about a week and a half, and I kind of like the guy. I don't know all about him, but I kind of like him. They got on the subject of the attack on Christmas. And he was ripping into everybody you can imagine. He was strongly against the idea of them removing Christmas programs from school and removing Christmas songs from school because they were attacking this whole, you know, this Christmas thing. His producer got online or got tapped in and said, well, now I'm with you, but I want to play the devil's advocate here. He said, what if that during that holiday, during Christmas, what if some other religion that had another type of Savior or God wanted their song sung, then the schools, to solve the problem, should let them sing their song. That did it right there. I grabbed my phone and I dialed that number. And you'd have heard, my name is James, that's what you would have heard. And so I waited, and finally they clicked on it. I said, I'm going to explain this to you the best way I know how. I said, here's what we're talking about. I said, no other religion that I'm aware of celebrates Jesus Christ's birthday on December 25th besides the Christian belief. And he said, yes, that's right. I said, you have a birthday, Leland, and I have a birthday. How would you feel if I came over to your party and said, hey, I got a birthday. It's not today, but I've got a birthday, and I want half of your presence. You know what he said? Well, I'd probably punch you in the face. I said, that's exactly right. He goes, you know what? He said, that's a pretty valid point. He said, December 25th is what we choose to celebrate Jesus Christ's birthday.
Yeah.
So all these other religions, celebrate them on your birthday. But it's another example of how they want to remove Christ, remove God. They don't want to. They're even wanting the armed forces now to back off from anything that has to do with God in any of their pledges or quotes or something. Folks, this is why the country is in the shape that it's in today. It's because they are not letting God run the country. They are letting government, they are letting humanism, they are letting homosexuality run the country. You may think I'm on the high horse, and maybe I am, but it's because I know that when my kids and your kids grow up, you think the economy is going to be any better? Absolutely not. It's going to be worse than it is right now. So what do we need to do as a church to stay alive? We need to give. Come on now. We need to give. I'm not just talking. we need to give to every aspect of Christianity. We need to give our time. We need to give our worship. We need to give our devotion. We need to give our love. We need to give right now like never before to show God that in the middle, watch, in the middle of an entire world that is filled with unthankfulness, in the middle of an entire country that is boiling over with unthankfulness, we as a church, we as God's people, are going to continue to be thankful. It seems like the more that I listen to the news, the more disgusted I get. I really do. It's disgusting how they don't want to. There's such an attack on Christianity. There's such an attack on anything that has to do with God. And it's because they're not thankful. We're living in a world right now, or in a country right now, rather, where it's all about what I can get for free. Do you understand that? It is all about, oh, but Maroney, you're all about it. You're against helping, but no, I'm not against. The point of Christianity is to help people that cannot help themselves. And that's where it stops right there. People that cannot help themselves. You know how many people in this country can help themselves, but they will not help themselves because we're busy helping. And this is why we're in the shape we're in. They want everything that they can get for free. Give me, give me, give me. And it doesn't matter. I don't care what you hear on the radio. It doesn't matter. Republicans, Democrats, doesn't matter. Alley cats, it don't matter. What matters is God's got to stay smack dab in the middle of everything we do, or we will be cursed. We'll be cursed as a country. We'll be cursed as a people. But thank God that there is a church that says we will not choose the curses. We're going to go to the mountain of blessings. That's what we're going to do. That's how we're going to live. And our nation is rapidly going downhill. We're faced with innumerable kinds of problems.
Yes.
You know what happened back in the Old Testament? It was prophesied, a nation shall come against thee from afar, a nation whose tongue thou wilt not understand, and they will come as swift as the eagle flying. And the Bible prophesied, the Word of God prophesied, that they would actually turn upon their own children to stay alive. You know what happened? You know what happened? In the gates of Samaria, they were shut up, and the king was walking on the wall one day, and two women came arguing because we made a deal. We would boil and cook and eat my son today to stay alive and then do hers tomorrow. But whenever it came tomorrow, we already boiled and cooked and ate my son. But she hid her son. And king, I want you to set this right. Really? That's the Bible, folks. You know what caused that city to be in that shape? Ingratitude. The Bible says it. They ate their meat and they did not give thanks.
Right.
They were not thankful. So the Lord said, shut the city up. Nothing comes in, nothing goes out. And we know it leads to the story of the four leprous men sitting at the gate. It leads to that story. Folks, we got to get it. We've got to get this thing. We don't want to be, oh, Brother Roman, I would never, but I guarantee you that those people never thought they would boil and cook their own children. Oh, Brother Roman, we're not going to boil and cook our own children to stay alive. I'm going to tell you something. The people in the world, they may not be boiling and cooking their own children, but if you, listen, I'm going to tell you something. Don't think it's totally unimaginable.
Right.
Because there are people in this world that do things to children today.
Yes.
That are despicable, deplorable.
Yeah.
I just heard on the radio today about a young girl that was walking either to school or coming home from school, and a man and pulled up in a panel van, opened up the door, pulled her inside, shut the door, and then brutally, sexually assaulted her. No thought for human life. No thought for morals, no thought for respect. We are living in a country that is losing its ability to know God. And we have to do something. I want to be a culture of thankfulness.
Yes, sir.
I want our church to be a culture of thankfulness.
Yes, sir.
I want to be, you know what? It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter whether it's your tithe, your offering. offerings, your building fund, your Love My Church, whatever it is. Folks, this is not about anybody getting rich. This is not anybody. This is about the kingdom of God. That's what this is about.
Yes, sir.
Showing blessing. And this Thanksgiving, when you either deep fry your turkey, oven cook your turkey, or smoke your turkey, whatever you plan on doing to that turkey, whatever you do, just understand that there's people that don't have one. Understand, I thank God because every year this church has worked very hard at feeding people and doing things and raising money to try to think. Last year we fed like, I don't forget how many families in this county that we fed. Folks, that's what we're supposed to do.
Yes.
Because we're grateful. Amen. Anybody else grateful?
Yes.
Stand with me tonight. Amen.